Maseches Bavakam Daf Mem Ches Amud Aleph, towards the bottom of the page, the line is Ve'omar Rove. That's a few lines before the bottom of the narrow lines. Ve'omar Rove. Yeah, today's Gemara is not so hard, and also will give us a very nice opportunity to revise a lot of stuff that we've seen before in the past few days. This year is L'ul Nishmas of Imoyer Menachem Ben Akiva and the Sobas Moshe of first Pnina Gula Pnina Chabas Gula Ochel Akiva ben Zora Noach Lionel ben Yulia Oria Esor Shachol Yisrael Roma Rove Ichnis Shor Lachatzar Baal Abayis Shaloi Birshus. A person brought in his shor to the courtyard, to the domain of Baal Abayis, with no permission. Vizik is Baal Abayis. Then the shor harmed, injured Baal Abayis, or Baal Abayis huzak boy. Either hizik is Baal Abayis means active, what you call active. The shor actually gored him, bit him, kicked him, I don't know what it did to him, yeah? Spat on him, whatever. Or Baal Abayis huzak boy. Baal Abayis was damaged by him, meaning the bull was just like sitting there, not doing anything, sitting bull. And then, yeah, the chief. And then huzak boy, the Baal Abayis was indirect injured through him, by him. Chayev, the owner of the bull, is chayev, because what? Your bull is doing here all kinds of nezikin. We'll discuss later exactly what the nezik is. Potter. So the Gemara now continues the statement. Rovatz potu. If he crouched, if he lied on the floor, the bull is potu. If he's a crouching bull, sitting bull is potu. Now the Gemara says, what? Is potu. In other words, even though as he's crouching, as he's sitting down, he may be hitting some kelim, some vessels, and break them, or he sits down and then a Baal Abayis mistakenly bumps into him, is potu. The Gemara, what? Why on earth is that? Why would you tell me that he is potu because he's roivetz? And now we're coming, by the way, to a different question. You tell me, when somebody bumps into a sitting bull, sitting duck, sitting bull, what kind of av nezikin is it? Tamazoi? Regel. Why is it regel? Is he walking? He's not walking. He's sitting. What?
No.
A bull.
And the winner is Peretz. To everyone in class, yeah, lachish, yeah. So it's I would say it's a bull, though it's not so simple. But the hashkafa rishon, I'm not saying everyone else is wrong, but my first idea, it's a static thing. I don't care if it's a bull or it's a box of I don't know, of bricks. But I say, why is it potu? Why do you say that it's potu? Came without permission. I had no idea he's here. I bumped into him. I'm the Baal Abayis. Why is it potu? I'm a pope. My rovatz, you know what rovatz means? Rovatz does mean to crouch or to sit, yeah, rovatz kari, but here means something else. Shehir bitz glolim, excuse my language, he defecated, I'm sorry. Here bitz glolim, here bitz, the glolim are glolim, yeah, excrement. Ve nitan fu kelav shel Baal Abayis, which means, this is what? This is a story of glolim, of gedolim, that came from the bull. Later on, yeah, after they were like sitting in the Baal Abayis's living room, yeah, can you imagine this happening in your house while your wife is around? Yeah, so then she'd be very happy with that neighbor who brought the shor without permission, and the shor did his toilet in the middle of the living room. That's also nice. Yeah, so friendly. And then what? And then everything, yeah, we accept everybody in our home. So then afterwards, the kelim, somebody else brought the kelim and they got dirty from the excrement, yeah? Let's say somebody else by mistake brought the kelim after the tsoya, the glolim was there already, and then the kelim got dirty, really dirty, with the bull's, with his feces. So why do we say that he's potu? What's the ptur all about? It's not soros, very nice. Why is it not? You're very nice. You guys are doing great today. Why don't we say it's soros? Because I stress time and again, if it happened while he was making, when the process is in the making, that's soros. Here I stressed that it's happening after the glolim were already stationary. After the glolim were sitting pretty in the middle of my dining room, then somebody came and something happened. Like kelim, not a person. Then let's say a kli came and somebody brought a kli and got dirty through there. It's not slow. So what is it? The havia glolim bo. The glolim, once, you know, sitting down, that's already a bo. So why is it potur? Because the thing that were harmed, so to speak, by the glolim were kelim, were dishes. Somebody, let's say, mistakenly placed the nice crystal vase, the crystal kelim, on the glolim. Yeah. So then, now they got dirty. That's bo. Veloy matzinu bo shechir bois kelim. Bo is not chayv on kelim. We said each one of the four obvious nezikin, each one has its idiosyncrasies, his exceptions to the rule. One of them is sho veloy odom. Chamol velo kelim. This is a line which we have to know about. Peh from Daf Kaf Ches Amud Beis. One second, please. In other words, the Torah says, "V'nofal boy shor chamol." Only if animals fall into the pit, the baal habo chayev. Or if it's not a pit, it's a 3D kind of bow. If it's animals, you chayev. Or if it's a human being that was injured. But if a human being died in a bow, or food, by the way, or kelim, any vessels, any kelim, if they fell into the boar, or in this case, they bumped into the boar, got dirty. Oh, that's a better example. Let's say somebody's walking down walking up and down the dining room with a kelim in a bag, something, yeah? And then, nice expensive bag, and he's brushing against what? Those disgusting glolim, and he hit the glolim. It's like hitting a bow. You're potter. Why are you potter? Because bow is potu from kelim. Yes. This the entire shir is beautiful chazor and everything we've done. You should know Bava Kama, Stamazo, I'm stopping here and I'm recorded. The Rosh Yeshiva has always said, Bava Kama, you can't start learning Bava Kama Biyun until you don't learn about the first 50 dapim. Bava Kama, if you notice, is all very intertwined. There are definitions, Shorch Mor, but a lot of things repeat themselves. Not every Masechet is like that. You learn Shabbos after 9 dapim, goodbye, Hoitzo. We start with many definitions, then to Avatar, Dafiza. Here it's all very enmeshed together. So, you know, you have a lot of, you know, opportunities to review again and again what you've seen 10 dapim ago and 20 dapim ago. So here comes the question. Okay, so those kelim, what are they? They are the bow. Now, let me ask you a question. Please do not think like Westerners. Think like people many years ago or people who live in the more agricultural areas. When your shore, language, defecates, would you say that the glolim are hefker or do you want to own them? Don't laugh at me.
I want to own them.
Many people would want to own them.
Fertilizer.
And in many places in Central Asia, no, that's a good fire fuel.
But if I own it, then I can't.
That won't help you. Even if you don't own it, the Torah puts it in your shoes even against your will, so that won't help you anyways. Fred Digmara, you're on the ball. Ha, Nichal Shmuel. Well, you're telling me that those glolim are what? Are bo? That's okay, according to Shmuel, which we've seen at the beginning of third perek. What did Shmuel say? Shmuel said, any takala, what's takala? Any kind of something you may trip on, any kind of obstacle in Rishus HaRabim is bo, regardless of whether you own it or you don't own it. It's always bo. Shmuel says, bo is a bo, is a bo. Any 3D object in the street that's disturbing and people fall upon and trip on is bo. I don't care whether you own it or you don't own it. Because l'maisa you're chayv at the end of the day. The Torah will make you own it only for the negative things, right? Ela le'rav, according to Rav de Omer ad de mafkalei, remember Rav and Shmuel when you slipped into the puddle, yeah, beginning of third perek, and Rav said only if you're mafkil. Bo, by definition, is only if you mechavon merotzon, your own goodwill, you disown it, so to speak, you mafkil, then it's called bo, because bo is hefker, bo is not yours. If it is owned by you, it's called show. So therefore, you guys were not wrong. Peretz was right, but other people are also right. If you have a sitting bull in the middle of the street and it's still owned by the owner, he wants the bull, expensive. So then Shmuel would say this is bull, and Rav would say it's show. It's a sitting show, and it's hard to connect it to any of the other items of shore, but it's a show. Okay, so according to Rav, this is a problem. Those glolim, yeah, are mine. It's my glolim, and therefore they are considered to be maybe what? Like show. They're a derivative of the shore. They're not bow because they're still mine. If so, my ikalamema, what would Rav say? First wide line. Why are you telling me you're potter? I'm not potter. Why? Because it is not bow is potter from kelim, but things that are not bor, like show. Remember what we said? Show is like a proto, is like the, no, the uber av melocho, av nezikin. Show, if you can't fit anything else, you put shor in the box. Yeah, to be sure, you can put shor. So Rav says, ah, this belongs to me, it's not bor. Ah, so it's shor. Show, who harmed the kelim? Of course it's chayev. If he, so why are you telling me that the kelim is, I'm potter on the kelim? Answers the Gemara, Amri, now we're back to our comfy zone in the Western world. Stam glolim of kulim afkilehu. Opa. The Gemara says, no, the assumption is that glolim, stam, unless known otherwise, the glolim are hefkel. We don't say that the glolim are always kept by the person. We assume that the glolim are hefkel. He's not interested in those disgusting glolim, unless he shows that he is interested. I guess not every glolim is good for every field. Not everyone is a farmer in Kazakhstan. And therefore, when the person is has a glolim there, who are now nicely placed in someone's dining room, so then we assume the glolim are not his, and therefore, according not only according to Shmuel, even according to Rav, it's considered as bo. And because the item that was damaged is kelim, kelim with a bo, nishka shirich, you're not chayv on that. He put them there without permission. He's not a nice man. He's over v'after lecha kamoicha. Don't offer him as a shirich to my daughter. In the CV, you should write, yeah. Does not put his cow in the neighbor's salon, and the cow does this and that. Okay, but lamaisa, at the end of the day, it's not called, what is it called? It's called bo, because it's hefker, and bo from glolim is potu. And chrami, if a person would sleep on that, if a person would sleep on those glolim and would injure himself, what would be the halacha? Chayev. That's enough kamina. Let's say a person walks with a dog in the street. It's me and the dogs again. My agenda against dogs. Yeah, I'm a very big fanatic from the Chemish. Hi, everyone all over the world. Yeah. Let's say a dog in a Rosh Hashanah does what he does. And let's say the person doesn't clean after his dog, which is completely science fiction, of course. And then what? And then somebody comes and slips on it and injures himself. Not die. He didn't die. He only broke a leg. So the dog owner is high because of bo. Is mafkir the fichi, and it's bo in Roshus Harabim, and the person fell on it. Shov loy odom is only if the person died. That was your question, a good question. But if the person was harmed or injured, the yuchayev in bo. So the ma'aseh, dog owner walks down the street and doesn't clean after himself, and somebody slips. Yeah, it may look very funny in candid camera movie, but it's not really funny. And then what? And then the person, the dog owner, is chayv mitzad bo. Sorry for the fanaticism. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Everything good? Yes. Arav Peretz. Another statement of Ove. We're not talking now about animals anymore for the next 5 minutes. We're talking about people who hurt each other physically. Nichnas lechatzar ba'al habayis sheloi v'rshus. A person entered the chotzer of ba'al v'rshus. By the way, this is Chazor for Daf Lamed Aleph. Iran Lamed Aleph, there's a similar case. A person came into Chotzer Baal Bais with no permission. Yeah, you go out to your Chotzer, your dining room. But the Chotzer back then was like our dining room. They did a lot of things in the Chotzer. And you see a person there, uninvited guest. You never invited him to come. He came without permission. Uh-oh, trespasser. The Yizik is Baal Bais. And he punched you in the face. Chas v'shalom. He was Mazik Baal Bais. He harmed Baal Bais either by mistake or willingly or unwillingly. Somebody else hit the Baal HaBais. If he does it unwillingly, is that a reason to patter him? Is that a reason to exempt him? Because, oh, he didn't know that he's punching your face by mistake. Would he be exempt? Yes or no? No, he would not be exempt because Adam Muad. Beautiful. Daf Chavov Amud Aleph, the bottom of the page, Mishnah. Oy Baal HaBais, who's a boy? Or Baal HaBais bumped into him. He's sitting there having his coffee without your permission, and you mistakenly bumped into him, then chayev, of course he's chayev. He is a trespasser. Passively or actively, he is hitting the Baal HaBais. He's chayev. Heziko Baal HaBais potu. If a Baal HaBais hit him, if Baal HaBais injured him, Baal HaBais is potu. Yeah, because he did not allow him to come in. So if he hit him, he's potu. Zogimar, what? Wait a second. Omar Pope. Loyamoron, that is only true to say the Baal HaBais is exempt if Baal HaBais did something wrong. Ela de lo have a yodabe. He did not actually recognize that he's there. He did not know that he was there. In other words, he never invited him. And currently, at the time of Maisa, he didn't know that the other guy is there. Then what do we say? Then we break the rule of Odom Wad Loilom, says Toistres in Sanhedrin Dafa in Vov. We don't always say Odom Wad Loilom. If a person was not invited to my house, I don't want him in my house. And I didn't know that he was there. And then by complete mistake, I went and boom, I bumped into him and I hit him. Then I'm potter, and we don't sell the mod loilum. There are a few exceptions to that rule. There is a gvul to how much I have to be responsible. You're never invited to my house. You vote for the wrong party. Stop, I'm joking. And what? And also, I didn't know you were here. I really didn't. Our edim, I had no idea you were here. I was walking, boom, I bumped into you. Then Balabais is potu. Odomod loilum has its limitations. Aval, have a yodabay. Let's say he knew that he was there. He was uninvited. I'm quite upset the person is here, but I knew he's here. I'm Balabais and I know that he's there logically. Then what? Heziko Balabais chayev. Then the Balabais hit him. Yeah, even by mistake is chayev. Why? My time. Why is that? Well, simple. Mishum de omer lei, because the trespasser can tell the house owner, Nehi, what's Nehi? Although. Although you have permission to force me to go out, you can tell me, ask me, beseech me, implore me, threaten me, call the police on me. You can make me go out of your house without, since I'm here without permission. You can't actually harm me. Yeah, we're not living here in the jungle. You can't just punch me on the face, so I should go out. Try other ways, yeah? But you can't just be mazik me, even if it's a mistake, by the way, because Odom Od Loilom. Yes, by the way, this is a combination of Rove and Rav Pope. Quickly, yes?
There has to be an exception to that because you don't know
if it's a Rove. Vaita. Both Rove and Rav Pope were the authors, combined authors of this statement. They follow their own logic, their own reasoning. Doma Rove, Vitema Rav Pope, Rove, and some say Rav Pope say, they say the following. Shneim Bershus. Let's say two people are staying in Bilshus. Yeah, they are in a place where both of them are allowed to be. Look at Rashi. First Rashi. Kigon Bilshus Arabim. Everyone's allowed to be in the street. Or it's a place where both you and I are partners. Like the case of Peretz and I from yesterday. The Balabais invited him as a guest. We're both allowed to be here. Let's say both people are on equal grounds, equal footing. Excuse the pun, yeah? Or let's say there's a case of both people are in a situation where they're not allowed to be in. Let's say running in Rosh Hashanah. Remember? There was also Gemara in Daf Lamed Beis and Wadalef in the bottom. Lamed Beis. We say also people running in the street. You're not allowed to run in the street because it may harm other people, unless it's a jogging area. But to run, you know, really run hard, and then people, you may bump into people, you're chayv. Rishus Rabim is to walk normally. So let's say both of us are in equal grounds. Either both of us are in a place where we're both allowed to be, or we're in a place where none of us is allowed to be, or in a situation where we're both run like mishugoyim. Heziku zedze, chayovin, if they both harmed each other, they're chayv, even by mistake. Yeah, nobody here has superiority over the other. Yeah, you can't say, oh, I didn't know you're going to be there. Well, I didn't know you're going to be there either. Or we both know we're there. So then if they mazik each other, oh, the mod loilom chayv, who's kuzebazeb pturin? If they were harmed, yeah, indirectly, passively, you're running and I ran and I was the more active part, or let's say, yeah, or some kind of thing that, some kind, oh, let's say not running. Let's say both of them are bershus. Yeah, both of them are in a house where they're both allowed to be in, and you're sitting there with full permission, and I ran into you, and I bumped into you, you're potter, and I was harmed. I ran into you, I bumped into you, and boom, I was injured by that. You're a potter, because you didn't do anything wrong. You're sitting there like a sitting lemela, sitting duck. So what do we say from here? That's because none of them can say, I didn't expect you, I'm better than you. They're both in the same situation. So we say, we follow the same old dogma, same old rule of Odom Od Loilom, right? Unless it's really, really passive. Very nice. Taima, now let's be medaic. Let's derive something else from that. Taima, the shneim bilshus, or shneim shaloi bilshus. It's only because both of them are with permission or both of them without permission. Let's say one of them has the upper hand, one of them has more of a superior status over here, and he is allowed to be here and you're not. Like it's my house and you're a trespasser. The bershus potu, the one who's bershus and hit his friend without knowing he's there, even though it's an active thing. He went boom. Yeah, I'm like sitting on my couch and I'm stretching Shabbos afternoon. There's an uninvited guest. I told him, don't come to my house. I don't like it when you come. And he came nevertheless, and I didn't know that he came. Two conditions: no permission, and I'm not cognizant of it when he's there. and I'm stretching. Oh, boom, I bumped, I punched his nose without realizing I am potur, because he's without permission and I'm with permission. So in that case, I'm potur. Shaloi b'shus chayev. But if he did the same, if he punched my nose without knowing I'm there, he's chayev. What is he doing there, b'chlal? The mere fact he's there in my dining room without permission, so mimeila, he's chayev, because he's definitely, he has a lower hand over here. Okay? Weiter. It's not pshita at all. First of all, we see the big chiddush is that odom od lodom doesn't always apply. Secondly, we see that huzak, if I'm passive, even though I am not better than the other guy, but he bumped into me, I'm potter. Maybe odom od lodom goes to that extent. We see already two exceptions to the rule of odom od lodom. First of all, I didn't know he's there and he's not allowed to be there, and we need both conditions. Secondly, if I'm completely passive and he bumped into me and he was harmed, maybe I'm still chayv odom od lodom. We see two exceptions to the rule of odom od lodom. That, by me, is...
Odom can be quite to both sides.
No, but one harmed the other. No, it wasn't mutual. Every case here is not mutual. Either I harmed him or he harmed me. Let's say I'm the one who harmed. I'm Chas v'Shalom, Akiva. I'm such a nice guy. I don't want to harm anybody, but I did. He came to my house without permission and without any knowledge, and I bumped and I actively punched his face, not knowing what I'm doing. Then I'm potter. Yeah, but he would be chayev. That's a chiddush. Yeah. Nafal above Ivishmeimov. Where are we holding? Let's continue. Back to, yeah. Yes. What are you asking, Jeffrey? We are the fourth, fifth line from the top of the page. Two dots. Nafal above Ivishmeimov Chayev. Now we spoke in the Mishnah about a very interesting case. The bull fell into a bow, into a well full of water. And then it, excuse my language, what? Hivish means it stank up, to use the coarse language. Hivish meimav, boash. You know what boash is? Boash is a skunk. How do you say skunk in Hebrew? Boash. Yeah, boash. Why? Because mavish. Hivish is stank in nicer language, in higher language.
Dry up.
That's yavesh, without an aleph. Hivish with an aleph is hisriach. The kitzer, the bull, gave its fragrance into the water. We're going to see how. So then the bull is chayev, the bull owner, as Yitzchok corrects me always, is chayev. Why? Because the bull fell into the bowl and the water is now spoiled and ruined. Amar Rove, lo yishonu l'shivish b'sh'as nefila. Says Rove, if the bull, if as the shore was falling into the water and was still in motion, active, head diving into the water, and already at that very second it's stank up the water, then we say, what are you doing now? It's a chiyuv of shol, some kind of shol. You can say it's what? It's regel, maybe, as he's diving in, whatever. Maybe he's enjoying himself, and therefore it's shen. I don't know, but it's shol. Aval acher nefila potu. Let's say the shol is stationary in the water, and only afterwards it starts smelling up. After the shore is already static, then we say the water is potul on fashtunkinen up the water. Why? What did our esteemed colleague from London tell us a few minutes ago? A sitting duck, a sitting bull who sits passively in the water now, according to some people, is a bow. Zog de gmor, in my time, why is that? Havi shor bow. Isn't the coolest thing in the world? The shor is a bow. The shor is not a shore. He's a bow because he's stationary. He's statically there. He's not moving. The mayim, the water, whose item being damaged is kelim. Water is like kelim. I told you before, when we say shor v'lo odom chamo v'lo kelim, that is to say both vessels and foods and drinks and water, anything that's an inanimate object, is not chayev if it fell into the bar. So now we have a bow, who's a shor, who's sitting in the bow. So the shor is a bow, and the affected item is mine, is water. Cool. So the shor, who's really bow, because it's sitting there statically, is bow. Bow, who's now shtumkinen up the water is like kelim, is like a passive thing. Kelim, mimela, is potter on the water. Wow. Says the Gemara, okay. Again, the same question. Yeah, what you said was true according to Shmuel. But according to Rav, what did we say? A stationary animal, an animal that's positioned in the street, but is owned by me. Of course I want my animal, my beloved ox. I need it to plow. Then according to Rav, it is not bow. It's show. Freg the Gemara. Hanicha l'Shmuel. Everything you said over is beautiful and amazing and good, according to Shmuel. The Oma, what did Shmuel say? Kol takola bohu. Shmuel says any takola, any obstacle, stationary, as long as it's stationary, whether you own it or you don't own it or your grandmother owns it, I don't care, it's a bow. Yuchai mitzad bo. So that's very good. What we said is very logical. Ela l'Rav, but according to Rav, the Omar ad demafkir lei, Rav said only if you mafkir the item, you disown the item, such as a show, only then it's considered to be bow, but otherwise it's show. Michael Meimar, according to Rav, the statement is not true. Because according to Rav, even if the ox was sitting in the water or stuck in the water for 2 hours, it's never considered to be bow, because I, the show owner, I still want it. It's mine. So it's not bow. It's show. And if it's show that's harming the water, the show that's spoiling the water, of course you're chayev. So Rav's statement doesn't work according to Rav. The Rishonim here say that although halacha is like Shmuel, we know that in Bava Kama, it's almost like a lost game for Rav, kimat. Yeah, because halacha is always like Shmuel. But still, the Gemara wants Rav's statement to work well with both Shmuel and Rav. Because ideally, Rav would prefers that his statement should work according to both Rav and Shmuel. And therefore, but this statement does not work with Rav, right? Because a stationary shore, according to Rav, is not a bow. It maintains still the status of show, because he still owns it. Things owned by me are never bow, according to Rav. So what's the story? Now we have to tweak Rav. That's a big tweak, more than a tweak. We have to change Rav. Ela. If you want to learn Rav's statement and you want to fit it, make it fit into Rav's worldview, then you have to say the following. Amarove, you have to make another way, another exception to the rule regarding the water. Amarove, lo shonu l'shivish migufoy, says Rav like this. Let's say the animal, the actual body of the animal, let's say the animal of the bull, of the show, was full of mud, you know, cows in the cow shed, and not exactly like, you know, a chosen b'yom fuposo, they're not so clean. So let's say the cow, the bull, fell into the pit, and right away from the actual body of the animal, the water starts getting spoiled. It's full of all the little pieces disgusting from the cow shed. Then you're chayev on spoiling the water because it's a direct nezek, direct injure from the cow. As the cow was head diving, then all the cow shed odor, the perfume, is affecting straight away. That's like a maise beyadayim, direct damage from the cow. Aval hidish merechoy. Let's say the animal died, both dynamis. Let's say the bull died, and slowly but surely the body odor of the dead animal, yeah, of the cadaver of the animal, that starts stinking. That is potu. You potter on that. Why you potter on that? My time. Why? Grome be'alma. It's a grome. The grome be'alma lo mechayev. Upala. Grome, our good friend grome. In other words, if the animal did not affect the water straight away, the animal affected it later on. It started alive and then drowned and was dead. I don't think an animal that's dead in 1 second starts to stink, right? It takes some time. So that's more of an indirect process. And therefore, that's considered as grome. And this is a big, big, big yesoid. If your animal did anything with groma, you are potu. When am I chayiv if my animal did something directly? My show gored, my show kicked, my show something. Then groma, you are chayiv. That's not groma, it's a maise biyadayim of the animal. But if the animal did something with groma, then I'm potu. Because the bad smell, the bad odor came later on as like a secondary result, therefore I'm potu. And that would be true according to both Rav and Shmuel. Because I don't care whether it's show and chanami. According to Rav, don't scare me with your questions about Rav. Everything is good. I know that the show, through and through, is considered as a show. I know. Sure. Sure. But at the end of the day, because the nezek is indirect, both Rav and Shmuel would agree, indirect nezek is potu. I would ask you the question now. Yes, Akiva, what do you want? My question is, what's a Chiddush? My answer is, the Nimuke Yosef says, and the Ramban, in Kuntres Garmi, Ramban is a whole Kuntres about Garmi. Remember Mr. Garmi, what's Garmi in short? If you have to make a chart of Groma, Maise Be'adayim, and Garmi, who'd be in the middle? Who's like in between? Who's a fence sitter? Garmi. Garmi is something that's not completely direct, but not completely indirect. Like the guy who removes the mattress from the thing that's about to fall, in literally half a second it's going to happen. He didn't touch the cud. He didn't touch the jug that's about to fall on the floor, but he just removed the mattress. Yeah, that's, and therefore, yeah, he's going to hit it, and it's going to happen in half a second. That's Garmi. It's not indirect. He didn't touch it by a dime. Say the Rishonim, listen to this, even though we paskin that this should be Garmi, it's not a very indirect thing, because the animal fell in, let's say died straight away, and very soon it's going to stink. It's not a very indirect thing. It's not Maise Be'adayim, but it's also something, a process that starts slowly but surely right away could be Garmi, according to some Rishonim. Therefore, the Rishonim say an animal, not only is Potter Begroma, is even Potter Begarmi. A human being Begarmi is Chayiv. It's a huge machloikis. We Paskin Garmi or Chayiv. But the animals, even if Paskin by human beings, Garmi is Chayiv, by animals you Potter. And that's a wacko of a Chiddush. Only if the animal does something very direct, you Chayiv. Ay, Tzoros, Xeros Akosuv. Tzoros, Xeros Akosuv. Leave Tzoros out of the question, please, to make me happy. Because Tzoros says a Gemara. It's a Gemara, not me. It's a Lachlim Shemisinaim, which you don't understand. But normally, if an animal does something, if it's not super direct, it's Potter. And that's the story over here. That's a Chiddush. Weiter, question and comments. Continue, North Korea. What do you want? Which program do you choose? You want to stay in Israel or move to North Korea? Weiter. Now, boom, 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 boom. Where are we? Yeah, Hoya Aviv, Ibnoy, Lusoychem, Shams, and Koifa. Oh, now we're going to have another big summary of what we've been doing in the past few weeks. Continues the Mishnah, and we're now quoting the Mishnah. It's a quote from the Mishnah now. Hoya Aviv Abnoi Lesoichoi. Let's say the bull fell into a pit. Instead of water being in that well, let's say, his son, the father of, or the son of the Baal HaBayis, they were inside the pit. They were hiding from the Romans, from the Greek, Hanukkah time, and what? And they were actually sitting in the pit in the ground, and the bull fell on them and killed them. By mistake, he killed the people. So then, Mishalem is a koifer. The bull has to pay koifer. Ooh, that's some kind of chiddush over here. Let's see how everything unfolds in Mirtz Hashem. Frag the Gemara, the Amai, why does he have to pay koifer? Who has to pay koifer? Tam or Muad? Yosef is the winner. Only a Muad pays. Very good. Only a Muad pays koifer. Frag the Gemara v'amai. Why? Hatamu is a tam. The assumption is that the shor is tam. Why? Because he's doing something accidentally. Right? This is not a pattern that happened many times, or so we assume. So if that happened first time, since when does first time offense pay koifer? Now, you're not going to kill him because it was a mistake. Let's just, you know, remember old stuff, not so old, yeah? If an animal, let's say it's an honest mistake on the side of the animal, he just fell into the bow up, he had no idea what's going on over there. An animal that killed by pure mistake is Potter from Skila, like a human being, right? If you killed someone by complete mistake, I'm not talking Golos now. You are Potter from death. It shouldn't happen to you. Mashenken, not the Shenken, same thing by a show. Show too. A show killed by pure mistake, by accident, what? Potu. So this is a shol tam, acting by mistake. What he wants from his poor life? If saying should pay koifer, tam doesn't pay koifer. Answers the Gemara, Omarav, and we got that answer before. The muad lipol al pnei odom beboros haskinan. In other words, that shor has a history. It's a clumsy shol, and he did it already three times, and that's his fourth time. According to Rashi, koifer is but the fourth time. In other words, that happened already once, twice, three times, and every time it's a mistake. Yeah, every time it's a mistake. And what? He should fall, right? He's always falling. That's what we assume. And therefore, what? That's the fourth time. Fourth time is muad. And should pay how much? Koifer, however much they're worth. Frag the Gemara, Yehochi, if so, Bak Tolahu. Wait a second. If already he fell on the first time, yeah, he should already, what? He's a killer. And we assume that this is not really a mistake. In other words, in the Havamina, I jumped the gun a little bit. We're not so sure it's a mistake. If something happens in that way, in the Havamina, we think that he maybe had a Kavona. We saw him falling into the bowl. We don't know if it was a mistake or not a mistake at that point. So let's now assume that if it happened the first time and it's not a mistake, he fell on them and he killed them, first time is a Ktola. He should be put to death on the first time. How did he survive three times? Yeah, now it's the fourth time it's happening. The same thing again and again and again and again. And you want to tell me it's always a mistake? Really? And you don't want to tell me that you killed him already the first time? How did he survive it? How did he live to tell the tale? And now, the fourth time, you're dealing with his koifer. The first time already, he should be put to death. Rashi now, there's a brilliant, the old Rashis are brilliant. You have to see this Rashi. Rashi is saying something brilliant. I want to test your memory. Before you see Rashi Barktolo, you can already start looking. Rashi Barktolohu, it's a few lines, only like three, four lines above where the Gemara is. Tell me, guys, do you remember when we spoke about that sugya in Daf Mem Aleph, we asked the question back then, how can you ever have a show that survived, that actually makes it to kill people four times? Now he's going to pay the koifer, mazel tov. He should have put to death the first time. What did we say?
He ran away.
Ran away. Mrs. Rosen, you're going to know. Okay, that's Rambam. Let's leave those alone. It's not according to Rashi. He ran away. Or we said, let's say, we didn't recognize which shore it was. It was a muad, meaning it was really this shore, but they never recognized this particular shore. They warned Balabai three times, and they said, your entire herd, there's somebody wild over there. And only by the fourth time, they recognized which one it was. So every time they couldn't recognize him to kill him, but he, Lemafrea, at the end of the day, retroactively, we saw, oh, yeah, now they ate him. No, yeah, that was the one with the white spot on the side who killed all the times. Says Rashi, even if you don't see Rashi inside, wait, all these cases don't apply over here. Why? You can't say that we don't recognize him, and you can't say that he ran away. You know why not? Because this show, such a dramatic thing, he fell into a pit with the father and son inside. He didn't make it outside alone, says Rashi. Somebody pulled him out and straight away put him in jail, in the animal jail, straight away. And you can't say nobody recognized him. He was a kol gadol. There was isla kol, says Rashi. There's a voice, there's rumors. Wow, that's big news. It's a big news item. So says Rashi, all those very nice creative answers of the Gemara and Aleph are not going to work over here. I don't accept the fact that the show ran away because it was fell into a pit and people picked him up and surely took him to Beis Din, or at least the Edim know exactly who he is because he's recognized. Therefore, the Gemara has to look for a new answer over here that did not apply over there. Omar of Yosef, the chozo yeroiko venofal. Every time the animal can't control its yetzer hara for food, every time it sees some greenery, it sees some green lush vegetables, whatever, grass in the pit, and every time it wants to eat, and this is what, this is Shane, and it was not mechaven to kill them. He's not mechaven to kill them, and he fell inside. So that's why he's considered as what? Very, very. Here comes a big Rashi, which summarizes a lot of things which we've learned. What? Oh, very good. So first of all, he's not a tam anymore. Because it happens four times, and every time he wants to eat food, and he's genuinely trying to eat food, he's not trying to kill anybody, and it's proven. You can see the shore is all hot on the food, and not on the people. The people are hiding. He doesn't see them. He's only out. He's only after the food. So now, mitzad him being chayev misa is not chayev misa. Chayev misa is only keren. This shore, you know who he is? He's the shore who kills through shen. Says Rashi, if I'm not mistaken, it says Shen. Yeah, at the end, he says over here, yeah, it's a Shen. Ends a Shen. It's Kavanan also. Yeah. This guy, the show, wants to have nice food, Misken. So he killed people through Shen. And we paskin in Daf earlier, I don't remember when, that if a Shor kills without Karen viciously, he kills someone by walking all over him because it's comfortable for him to walk on the person. Or he wants to eat vegetables off the person and he bit the person. So that show, mitzad koifer, he has to pay koifer.
But mitzad killing, he doesn't get killed. To kill a show, you only kill a show when you kill a show when it's keren. B'chavona is amazing. There's a roshe. That's what the roshe is, a roshe. The show. You kill him for being vicious and killing b'mezid, murderer. Mashenkin, when you talk about koifer, it's shaykh to pay koifer. It does pay koifer, even though he killed them innocently by eating, but just wanting to eat the grass. So now the answer is a very good one. I'm not even saying the entire Rashi. I hope we have time to read this amazing Rashi, but I'm just telling you the kitzer. The story is as follows. He really fell one time into the pit, and it was Shane. He killed someone with Shane. He's potu, he's not chayv skila, because he's not keren. If it's not keren, not chayv skila. Okay? It's like a mistake, or like Shane. Second time, third time. Does he pay koifer? Ma pitom? So why do you keep counting the times? Because if for the fourth time he's going to kill through Shen, in the same form of Shen, of trying to bite the grass under the boar, then he's going to pay koifer. Skila, we don't have skila when it comes to the matzav of killing by Shen. But koifer, sure there is. If a show is a mu'ad, listen to my careful definition, is mu'ad to kill through Shen, he's always trying to eat the grass, but ends up killing the people. But the fourth time, he has to pay koifel. And that's the story over here. I'm censoring some of Rashi because I want to have the flow of the Gemara, but I really hope to have time and then answer. Okay, so that's answer number one. The kitzer, the show Muad, is a very, very particular Muad. He always, Misket Shlomazel, he always falls into the pit, trying to eat, ending up killing. Killing, you don't kill the show. He's not a murderer. But koifel, the fourth time, yes. That's the crux of it, according to Rav Yosef. Shmuel Omar. Shmuel has a different answer. Shmuel says he's a tam. Omani, you know who's this Mishnah following? Rav Yosef Aglili. Remember that? Rav Yosef Aglili was shot twice already. No problem. The show is a tam. I don't believe it's so easy to have four times exactly the same case. No. It happened one time only. One time, and it's still a tam. Why is he paying koifer? Because the follower basically. Basically said that the shotam pays half a koifer, just like a shotam pays half of anything, but koifer pays half. We're not passing basically that. But that's mission, is the king, no problem. He's a tam, it's a very rare case, only one of. Why is he paying koifer? Good news, basically, he's the man, and he's the author of the Mishnah. Bam, 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 bam. Now, Ula Omar. Ula says the same thing with a tweak. Rabbi Yossi Aglili, the Omar Kerb Talfon. Our Mishnah combines two Machmir opinions. Rabbi Yossi Aglili plus Rab Tarfon from yesterday. What did Rab Tarfon say? The Omar Keren B'chatzar Nizak Nezek Sholem Mishalem. Remember that? We mentioned it yesterday. It's a Mishnah in Daf Chavdal Adamud Beis, Chafei. We said over there, Rab Tarfon believes that if a Shol Tam viciously enters someone's private domain and does keren over there, how much do you have to pay according to our friend? Sholem, not killing. It's time. He killed someone's dog. A shol came in without permission into someone's field, private field, and he killed an animal. How much does he have to pay according to Rav Tarfon? That's a sholem. Kal v'chomer. Not chatzin nezek lokui pask in the mainstream opinion. Rav Tarfon says nezek sholem. Ah, look what's happening now. Rabbi Yosi Aglili, which says that a tam pays chatzi koifer, plus combined, this is a very nice combo, combined with who? With Rav Tarfon, it says that in the private domain, you always pay nezek sholem. Means what? At the end of the day, 1 + 1 = 2. Koifer by shotam, yes, he pays chetzi. In the private domain, we follow Rab Tarfon that says you always pay nezek shalem. = 3, that in the private domain, a shotam would have to pay full koifer. Basically, the path of Tarfon. The most machmir, this is Kol Chazonish over here. Achinami koifer shalem mishalem. Over here, Rav Tarfon says you pay full nezek inside. Basically, we say you pay koifer, full koifer, even though you're short term. That's what our Mishnah is advocating. Now, the Gemara is, now that we've said that, now we come to, that's now the cherry on top. Says, did you notice, people, my dear friends, that the Mishnah spoke about his father or his son being in the bow? Why not just anybody? Why father, son? Why relatives of Baal HaBayis? Says the Gemara, now we're going to get to the punchline. Bishma le'ula, according to Ula, I understand, ha'inu dektani ho'yo oviv abnoi le'soichoi. According to Ula, we're talking about father and son, you know why? Because they are Baal Abayis. You know that back then people lived in multi-generational homes, like the Indians today, the Arabs today, or some of us today. Sometimes young couples live with the parents because they have nowhere else to live. That happens today also. The grandfather, that also happens sometimes by us. Mimela, the father and the son is just an example to tell you that the nezik actually took place in the reshut sayachid of the victim, which according to Ula is very good. When you pay full nezik, like a tarfon, but it's in the reshut sayachid of the injured party. Very good. El Shmuel, but according to Shmuel, that Shmuel, what did he say? Shmuel says no, it's not necessarily the reshut sayachid. Shmuel says we're talking according to Rabbi Glili, that says the Tam pays half a koifer anywhere. Shut Rabbi, reshut sayachid, reshut outer space anywhere. El Shmuel, ma'ir aviv b'noi. According to Shmuel, why talking about family? Afilu acher nami, any person in a different house. In other words, even if he injured someone in the middle of the street. Let's say the ball wasn't owned by anybody. Stam, the shoe fell and hit someone, foreign person, a tourist, in the middle of Rehov Yafo, in the middle of Stam, not Dafka private domain, the same thing, right? You pay half a koif for it, it's a short time. So why do you talk about the father and son? Answers the Gemara, en chinami, urche demil sektani. The Mishnah didn't come to tell me any amazing chidushin. That's the norm. The norm is usually a person as his father or son, stam, they're sitting in the board. Stam, an example. It's lav dafka to tell me a whole halacha to indicate the Tushu Shayochim. Well, it could have been a tourist which has never been here before. The father and son is stam, an example for people who may be sitting in the board. But lav dafka doesn't necessarily mean to indicate that it's dafka in Lashu Shayochim. Questions? Comments? I want to tell you the Rashi. We don't have time to see Rashi inside, but you got to see this Chazara. Remember old memories. Remember what we said about the two things that go hand in hand together, to pay koifel and to get skila, right? It was a machloikis, big machloikis. Nachon, Rava said that if a shor gets killed, he pays koifer. If he doesn't get killed, like it's a mistake, it's a shoy gig of the shor, then there's no koifer either, right? There was Rabba. But then Rabbi Yochanan argued on him. They said, Im koifer, right? To tell me that even if the show doesn't die, he still pays koifer, right? Now, the problem is Rav supported the opinion that said that they go hand in hand together, Rav and Rabba. Yeah, they said that if you have skila, you have koifer. No skila, no koifer. Remember? In other words, let's say the shor did it by mistake, or the person admitted and says, my shor did it, is potu. Moide voice of Yerucham. Yeah, and then there's no koifer either. That's what Rav said. Rav said, if there's no killing, there's no koifer. Here, Rav seems to be saying otherwise. Rav is the one who said over here, the first answer, that the shor fell again and again and again and again. He kept falling into the bowl in an oifen of shame. And therefore, even though the shor doesn't get killed because it's just shame, but he still pays the koifer for the fourth time. Says Rashi, it's not a contradiction. When the show really is vicious, the show is really a behemoth with his horns or his feet or his teeth, he's killing Bechavona, but there's a loophole because he meant to kill Reuven and he killed Shimon or his owner admitted in Beis Din, then he's Betz Merotzeach, a loophole. We say, there's no Retzicha, there's no Skila, no Koifel. Is out of the question, out of the radar. But Shenken over here, when it's Shen, a show who kills through eating or wanting to eat the grass, he's Bechlal not in the Parsha of ever being killed. That box called Shen never grants the show Skila, right? Mimela, in that case, we say the whole thing of being a muad is only to get koifer at the end of the day. We count one innocent falling, second innocent falling, third innocent falling, fourth one. Why did you get to the fourth one? To pay koifer. A koifer by Shen exists. Why? There's no skila. It's never meant to be skila by Shen. Shen and skila never go together. Mimela over here, Rav would say, even though there's no skila, there is koifer, because that's the whole word of koifer in Shen. Koifer in Shen would never meant to have skila with it. In this case, there's no skila, but there is Shen with Koifer the fourth time. That's the answer of Rav. The Shenkin over there, who talk about a shore that with a loophole got out of the system, he gets free for everything. Both skila and Koifer, both were meant to be Mechayevim, and both he got exempt from, together, the hand in hand. Over here, by Shen, we never have skila, no such thing. The only thing is Koifel, that's it. That's what Shen, killer Shen is all about. That's where Rav over here is good with Rav over. That's basically, I told you the entire Rashi, basically. You see this long Rashi, you can look at it at home, but basically I told you the whole content of Rashi, most of it I told you. I think next time, thank you very much. There were a lot of reviews today, and you can review that here on www.yourshear.com, commercial time. Yeah.
Well, just to learn again.
Yeah, I'm listening.
There's such an entity as Hatzikoma.
We did.
I know
we
learned it.
Where?